Thank you. And howdy from Texas, where I'm missing the chaos of South by Southwest to be here, which is, if you've ever been there for it, it's a mess. We're going to have about 30 minutes to go over the rest of the world for 10 years, so I may talk a little bit fast at times. But I want to, if we're going to look forward, I want to look backwards first. And before we even do that, I want to open with a comment. And this is by Mackinder, who's one of the early proponents of geopolitics as a field. And he said this in 1919 after reviewing World War I. He said, there is in nature no such thing as equality of opportunity for the nations. And geopolitics, as we look at the world, we still think that geography matters. We still think that place matters and has a role. And that can be opportunistic, that can be a bit of a constraint, but it is still something real. And there are ideals, and geopolitics doesn't stop the drive toward ideals and toward wanting something different, but it does have a very real impact on the way in which the world works, on the way in which countries interact. If we go back to the end of the Cold War, what had happened was that there had been a stability during the Cold War between the United States and the Soviet Union that in many parts of the world were held in check. If there was going to be conflict, it was usually very constrained conflict. The Cold War was a very stable period for the world because you had two competing blocks of power holding everything together. And when you saw the end of the Cold War, you saw that start to fracture in the space between them. You know, from Yugoslavia and Kosovo breaking all the way up through into the Middle East, moving now into Central Asia, that whole space started to break apart. Well, in that time, though, a new kind of world structure started to take place. And that was one that had three central pillars to the global economy and to the global, really, political structure and strategic structure. And that was the United States, it was the European Union, and it was China. And China was this economic driver, the European Union was in many ways a political driver, the United States a security pillar, but they all interacted with each other, and much of what went on in the world looked at those three and tried to find places to balance between those three. And when we move to after the global financial crisis, we see that this structure starts to break apart, that these pillars are no longer standing there as a understandable world system. And that's what we're living in today, is a world that has had that center broken, right? The United States housing crisis sent the Europeans down their track, which sent the Chinese down their track. The Chinese were much more dependent on Europe as an export market than the United States. And if you look at the timing, it was the European slump, much more than the US slump, that led the Chinese to where they were at. But the Chinese were also at the end of their economic run. So if you look at the way East Asian countries have been going, they build into this run of low-end manufacturing, they rise up, up, up. At a certain point, the labor costs catch up with the rise in their economy, and it's very difficult for them to maintain that low labor, low-cost model. And so what they do next is they try to change to an internal consumption model, which is what the Chinese are trying to do right now. That's not a rapid and easy thing to do, go from being a low-end exporter to a high-end internal consumer. And we saw with Japan, we saw when South Korea went through that crisis, we saw when Taiwan did, we saw when the Southeast Asian countries did. This is not a simple, easy process. On China, it's going to be a much more complex process. So we have China now dealing with internal structures at the same time that's being forced to look outward, and we're going to come to this in a few minutes here. We have the European Union, where a lot of the underlying realities of Europe, which is that Europe is not a unified entity, it never has been and it never will be, started to come back up when they faced crisis. So the underlying realities of Europe broke apart. And then the United States, which has been in international global conflict for over 15 years, is starting to pull back. And this has nothing to do with Donald Trump or if Hillary Clinton had won or not. It was already happening. It's a process that's going to happen. After the United States has an extensive time abroad, particularly in military activity, it creates a sense of exhaustion domestically. And the US starts to pull back from those roles internationally. That's also a change in how the US sees its international role. Coming out of the Cold War, any instability meant the United States needed to intervene because it could change the balance with the Soviet Union and the Americans. Coming out of the Cold War, the United States still had that model. Instability by its very nature was considered bad, even though it didn't necessarily matter in the same way that it did during the Cold War. And the tools that were used was the military intervention, so that just kept going. Well, that pattern is very clearly not a functional pattern any longer, and that's pulling back. So we're going to see the United States take a less direct and a less interventionist role in much of the world, which means it's going to be relying relying more on its allies. It's going to be relying on regional balances of power. We're going to see a change from this singular global system to a lot of subsystems, sub-regional systems. That's what's going to be emerging. So let's walk through and see what this kind of looks like. In Europe, again, Europe is not a unified entity. Europe never was. Germany isn't even traditionally a unified entity. That's a pretty modern invention, Germany is. But if you look at Europe, Europe is starting to fracture back to these subsystems. You see a very strong rise in nationalism and even in subnationalism. In some ways, this is the extreme of what the Europeans themselves have been promoting on national self-determination. It's now come from hitting the former Soviet countries and other countries back into Europe, and that's causing them a little bit of heartburn. But the idea that Greece would be able to manage a financial crisis with the exact same fiscal tools as Germany was an impossibility. It was never going to work in that way. The European Union, whether it was going to be Grexit or Brexit or Italexit or whatever else they're going to have, Portchexit, you know, we had Brexit, but other parts may trim off. But the idea that Europe is going to become a single multinational, multi-state whole is I think, no longer on the table. There are a large number of elite within the European system who have invested a lot in this and still consider it the way to drive. But what you're seeing now is that to keep Europe held together, to keep the euro held together as a single currency, they have to get rid of some of the ideals of freedom of movement, of starting to shut and close borders internally, of allowing different speeds of economic activity, different ways of countries running their economies, and even different ways of focusing on their military and security. So Europe as a unit is starting to fracture. We would call it the disintegration of Europe. It doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to see the European Union disappear and just come back all to the same standard countries. It could be that they simply don't ever go further into that extreme integration, or that we start seeing sub-blocks within this Europe that have tighter integration but are less connected to each other. All the way over in Central and Eastern Europe, you see that strong attention still to Russia and to the security component. The front line of NATO has moved to Poland. It's not in Germany anymore. That's where it's looking. Russia has played a role in this. Russia is facing a demographic and economic crisis. And in 10 years, Russia is going to start pulling inward again. And much of what we've seen in the last 5 or 10 years is Russia trying to create a buffer space to be able to deal with this. If you look at the population numbers in Russia, if you look at the economic path in Russia, they're in a lot of trouble. And when Russia looks out at the world, Russia sees a world very different, I think, than we're used to seeing, right? If you look at this map, it's like upside down and it doesn't make sense, but it really does. Because from Moscow's point of view, this is what the world looks like. And when you think about Russia pushing out past Ukraine, past Poland, to the Carpathians, down to the Caucasus, out to the Tian Shan Mountains, you start to see the geography has consistently shaped Russia's view of the world and Russia's view of where it can feel secure. And why does Russia continue to try to take a strong role in Central and Eastern European nations' politics and security? Because it feels a risk and a threat from them. It feels that if those areas are taken over or integrated into NATO, integrated into the European Union, that those undermine Russia's ability to be a strong and secure state. And so when Russia moved on Ukraine because, from their perspective, they had an agreement with the West. The Ukrainian government went to the deal with the Europeans. The Europeans said, join and sign this new economic partnership. The Ukrainians said, no, we're not. We were just kidding. We're not actually going to take part in that. Russia was happy. Europe was a little upset. But then there was a revolution in Ukraine. And from the Russian perspective, that was thrown and supported by the Americans and the Germans, and it was clear then that the Americans and the Germans had broken the deal with Russia. And as you can see in there, if they move into Ukraine, there is no space left for Russia. And so Russia intervened in the same way they had done in Georgia, right, just a few years earlier. No one really cared about what happened in Georgia. In many ways, if you look at the European initial response to this, the Europeans were not very upset with Russia initially. Now, European people may have been, but the European leadership weren't, and certainly not the Germans, because of economic ties. And the Russians had been counting on the Germans investing a lot into Russia to be able to allow Russia to move away from resource dependency and start building industry. And the Germans and the Europeans were very much opposed initially to strong sanctions against Russia until the airline went down. And when the airline went down, that changed the social pressure on the European governments, which pushed them into the sanctions, which has driven them to this space. Russia's vision now is to the east. So when Russia looks at a way to re-strengthen itself, it's looking at Japan. not at China. China it already has relations with, but it's looking at Japan. If Russia is able to get Japanese investment into the Far East and access the resources in the East that are currently on the wrong side of the Ural Mountains and that are not really being drawn into the European system, then Russia owns the relationships out there because it's got Japan and China as consumers. If Russia only has China as a consumer, China owns the relationship. And so you see a lot of attention by Russia on its relationship with Japan, which is, of course, complicated by Japan's relationship with the United States. But from the Japanese perspective, they have a very strong interest in strengthening relations with Russia so that they can shift their defense focus further south and focus on China. So what we're seeing in Russia is a country that's trying to find a way to secure itself, secure its space, find an expansion of markets out to the east, but not allow itself to continue to be dependent upon a single consumer or single consumer bloc. Our view is that while Russia is currently a strategic issue, that in 5 or 10 years, that strategic risk or that perception of strategic risk from Russia is going to start to decline. If we look at the place where a lot of people look in the world into the Middle East, one of the things that you note right here is that where the Islamic State, where ISIS has been able to operate, is a very constrained space. So ISIS is now the big scary fear around the world. We'll see in a minute the how far it reaches. But it's very constrained in this battle space. And one of the reasons is that, and this is again back to why geography matters, why it helps to look at a space, when the United States went into Iraq and decided that it was going to liberate Iraq from itself, if you look at the structure of Iraq, there's a northern Kurdish area that has oil and gas, there's a southern Shia area that has oil and gas, and there's a central Sunni area that has sand. And it's a country that had been run by the central Sunni area, and they had dominated over the Shia and the Kurds. And when the US came in, it said, okay, we're going to reverse this, and we're not going to allow them to dominate anymore, we're going to pull them all out of government. But of course, the two populations who own all the resources that have been picked on all these years are going to give them free stuff and be happy, which obviously didn't work. And it created this internal space that runs actually over into Syria, where these people were being left behind by the change in what was going on within their own countries. They were getting picked on for what they had done for the previous 20, 30 years. And we now have a space that was open for something like Islamic State to rise up in. Every time Islamic State tries to move into a Kurdish area or into the Shia area, it's pushed back. It doesn't have that space to operate. We're seeing it being constrained further and further. Secondarily, as you look at this space and you think about what I said earlier on the United States starting to pull back from military operations and military intervention, if a lot of US military activity has been driven in the Middle East by oil and gas interests, and it really has, not only in the US consumption of them, but also for the supplies for the allies and for the rest of the structure of the world system, the change in the application of fracturing technology in the United States has altered that balance somewhat, right? I mean, I'm from Texas. If you fly over West Texas, it's a million little tiny squares of breaking up Texas underground. And that's changed global oil pricing, right? Consumption patterns, production patterns have changed such that the pricing is down. The United States, it doesn't mean the United States has no interest in the Middle East, but it means that the pressure on the United States to constantly intervene to deal with pricing fluctuations isn't there. And so what we're going to be seeing is the US starting to let the regional powers take a stronger role in balancing this space. As long as there's no single hegemonic power in the Middle East, it's okay for the US. Instability is okay. Singular power is not. So the Persians, Iran, are starting to reassert themselves and have been. Saudi Arabia and maybe working with Egyptians, Turkey coming down from the north. Those three can balance each other. The United States has a long history of supporting both sides in a conflict. It's fine, it works for it as long as it doesn't have to be directly involved. So what we're gonna see in this space is that start to happen. Russia has a hand in there. China is actually has an increasing interest in finding some way to stabilize that, which gives the US further room to pull back. You look at the Chinese are already starting to operate in Afghanistan. The US has more room to pull back because it doesn't have that responsibility. It draws China into the central land space. That pulls China away from the sea. That's a good thing for the United States, ultimately. When we think internationally in the spread of ISIS, I think we need to not think about it as the spread of ISIS, but rather as militant activity and ethnic and religious militant activity simply taking advantage of the ISIS brand name. Okay, if you think about the Philippines, this is not a new phenomenon. The Bongsamoro issue has been there for hundreds of years. That some of them now wave an ISIS banner does not mean ISIS has spread. It means they've simply taken on that name as a way to try to increase their revenues, right? We saw the same thing with Al-Qaeda. There's lots of groups that at one point had raised the flag and said, oh, we're part of Al-Qaeda. Then when Al-Qaeda seemed to decline and ISIS seemed to rise, oh, we're part of ISIS. Then when ISIS starts to decline, oh, we're part of ourselves. It doesn't matter. Think about these not in terms of some centralized power that is spreading out to these other places, but these other places that are localized problems trying to take advantage of an international entity and connect onto it, right? And as that international entity starts to decline, they're going to start pulling away from it just as much. So we're not as concerned about a global caliphate or the spread of this. It doesn't mean that terrorism as a tactic is not a bad thing. It doesn't mean that militancy is not going to take place. It doesn't mean that terrorist attacks in Western nations or in capitals is not going to happen. But what it means is that as a global systemic risk, this is not the top priority. In many ways, the top priority of the global systemic risk is understanding the change in the global economic balance and looking at the Asia-Pacific region. And when we look at Asia-Pacific, I really love this map because it's kind of striking when you think about where everybody is and where they aren't, right? A couple of things on here that always stand out to me really strongly. There's always a lot of concern that India and China are these two giant powers pushing against each other and competing and fighting. There's a huge chunk of mountains that separate India and China. You know, there's a massive gap between the two. It's very hard to get in between them. Yes, there's some competition, but it's not nearly like the political perception of what's going on there. You look at China. China is almost exclusively a coastal country. Okay? When we look at economic activity in China, I would argue that about 400 million people are part of this new economic class in China, this really leading middle class, upper class. Now, 400 million is a slightly large number. It's a lot of people, right? But think about this, there's 900 million people in China who are not part of this economic class. Now you could see that as opportunity, it's 900 million more oranges you can sell, or Chinese gooseberries or kiwis or whatever they're called today. But you could also see it as a major risk because for the last 30 years, the Chinese government has said communism, yeah, it's a great idea, but we're going to talk about economic opening and liberalization. And economic opening and liberalization, to make it work within the communist structure, says, okay, everybody's going to get rich, but it's okay that some people are going to get rich much faster than other people. And the Chinese have pulled millions and millions of people out of poverty. This is not to diminish this. But the gap between that coastal 400 million and that interior 900 million has grown massive in China. And with the slowdown in the Chinese economy, the Chinese government has come back and said, okay, we're done with that. Everybody's going to get richer. Everybody's going to have to stay about where they are now for a while. And if you are the people who have been sitting there waiting for your turn and not being too upset about all the corruption and all the chaos that's been going on, and it's sort of okay because eventually you're going to get way better, and now you're told, never mind, this is a major problem. And if you look at the Chinese, their number one strategic concern right now, and they're sending feelers out all over the world to gather information, is not the US military buildup in the Pacific. It is not what the Russians are doing. It's not IS or the movement of terrorism into Central Asia. It is what are US economic policies going to be, and are we going to be able to manage our internal contradictions while we're undergoing a massive change in the structure of our economy if the United States decides to try to put the squeeze on us? That's their number one concern. And China traditionally, if you think about history, it is from the interior that crisis and problems come, not from the edge. At the same time, China is forced to be part of a global system. Throughout history, China has been an insular country because it could be. It produced what it consumed, it consumed what it produced. It never needed to be a giant trading company country. The United States, when we took over the Mississippi Valley, we made too much stuff. We had too much agriculture goods. We had to export it. We didn't have enough people to consume it. So we became a maritime nation. China never had to do this. The Silk Road, that was for fun and profit, but it wasn't necessity. Zheng He's treasure fleet, he had giraffes from Africa that he brought back. And when they had problems at home, they burned it. It didn't matter. It wasn't a reality. Did they discover America? Who cares? They didn't stay. So But in the last 30 years, in the last 20 years in particular, Chinese consumption of key commodities has more than doubled their production of key commodities. And China is absolutely dependent for continued economic activity on an international presence. Most of this comes by sea, and so China pushes into the East and South China Sea, and they feel that when they do that, the United States is boxing them in. That the United States has built a military alliance that's designed to constrain and contain China. And so we see China now doing what they've never done before. They're putting all of their attention now on their Navy. And they're pushing out into this maritime space, and they're trying to push the US back. They're buying islands, or stealing islands, or building islands, or doing whatever they want with underwater features that they build. They're taking this for strategic reasons. They're taking this for fish and maritime protein. China last year had 51% of global catch for maritime products. And they are doing secondarily Belt and Road. Now, Belt and Road is a really interesting initiative. The Chinese have this idea that if you simply build a bajillion alternative routes, there's no single center of gravity that could be a target of the United States that could hurt them. It doesn't matter whether any of these are cost effective. That's not the point at all, right? The Three Gorges Dam was not cost effective. Digging the Grand Canal so that they didn't have to deal with a couple of Japanese pirates was not cost effective. But that's not the point. The point is to insulate them from any single strategic point that could hurt them, the Strait of Malacca type of issue. All of this is about building as many networks as they can, tying as much of this space in. But if you notice what's happening to the Chinese, they're being pulled in two directions simultaneously. Landward, and they're starting to have to move their defense forces to cover that, and seaward, and they're starting to have to build their naval forces to cover that. We remember what happened to Japan in that same issue back in the 1920s, 30s, 40s, when they had that same problem. I mean, they went and took China, and then they were stuck in the land, and they were stuck at the sea. But it starts to hurt your resources, it starts to hurt the way in which you can move your military, and it starts to create new tensions and frictions as well. And so the Chinese are being drawn at the same time that they're trying to deal with a massive political transition of the reconsolidation of power, and that's about being able to make rapid decisions. So 30 years of Chinese politics has been 30 years of consensus, right? Consensus is great in times of stability because you don't do anything radical. But at this moment, they need to do things radical if they're going to survive. If you don't do things radical, you're going to start having crisis after crisis after crisis hit you. So they consolidate power. Well, in consolidating power, you have to start cleaning house, and you have to realize that as you do that, initially everyone's going to agree with you, and then at a certain point, everyone's going to realize that they're about to be cut, or their interests are about to be removed, or they're about to be removed themselves. And so you're going to start to see political pushback in China. That's going to be shaping what goes on there. Look at the rest of the region, though, right? So as China also moves back from this low-end manufacturing, there initially appear to be opportunities for other countries. Southeast Asia, massive population growth coming, right? Urbanization coming. Indonesia took the great risk of angering all of the mining companies at a time when it probably couldn't afford to do so, to try to change some of the economic dynamics such that at least some of the islands other than Java were able to earn some money as well, by forcing the mining companies to start doing some of the refining in Indonesia, things of that sort. But this is a place that's incredibly dynamic. Why did the United States initially decide that it was going to join the TPP? And remember, this wasn't under Obama, this was under Bush Jr. He's the one who started the drive for the US to be part of TPP. It was because this was seen as the next big area of growth. Obama moved it to become a very political issue. This was seen as a way to reshape the rules of global trade in a political way, not really necessarily in an economic way. But that this area was very important. So the United States, to be part of, work with ASEAN, needed to work with all 10 of ASEAN. So suddenly we rehabilitated Myanmar, and now the military is not bad and everything's fine, so we can work with them. But if you look at Southeast Asia, if you look at, say, East Africa, if you look at parts of Central America and Mexico, these are the next big areas where there's still a lot of space for growth. In Europe, probably there's growth, but it's pretty flat. In China, they're going to be having growth, but it's going to be internally driven and internally consumed. In the United States will keep growing, but right now it's undergoing its own issues. This is the space for expansion. TPP. Again, for the US, TPP really had turned into a political tool, much more than it was an economic tool. And when it started to break down, both sides of the political spectrum started to go against it. There's still a lot of people in the US who support it for whatever it was, or who support trade, but what we have to think about as we're thinking about global trade, is one, there's a lot of other opportunities within the region, a lot of other ways. I think that if you look at RCEP, which is the Chinese initiative, ASEAN continues to push back against that. It's not necessarily beneficial for them. It doesn't give them all of the things that they want, and we've seen Australia take a lead against it. But this, I think, is the most important piece to look at. Global trade, the growth of global trade is slowing. Supply chains are going to start to shorten. As we look at these other political aspects that we're seeing in the world, as we look at the competition between countries, as we look at the drive for national economic strength, the idea that we're going to keep building these multilateral frameworks and having 60-country-long supply chains is starting to contract. If you look at changes in manufacturing and energy costs, you move into additive manufacturing rather than in traditional manufacturing, you have the ability to cut the overall cost to allow you to use higher cost labor, which means you can start to bring things back to your home countries for production. What we see developing, rather than broad global multilateral trade agreements, are much smaller regional and move to bilateral. The United States is going to be renegotiating trade agreements all over the place. This is not a new thing under Trump. This is things that were happening already. We just finished the renegotiation of the tuna fishing accord. Right, said, we're going to pull out. Then everybody decided to renegotiate. We got a better deal. This is what happens in trade. When the US starts to think bilaterally and think about itself, instead of thinking about a broad concept of a multilateral system as an ideal, it's going to come back in and be readjusting the way in which it works with other countries. Regional trade blocks, tighter integration in ASEAN, tighter integration in the Asia Pacific, tighter integration in the Americas, a vertical trading regime that's going to tighten up. You know, the threat on NAFTA may not nearly be as much a threat on NAFTA as a modernization of NAFTA. NAFTA was made before cell phones. How do you have a trade agreement that's supposed to be working on these three countries that was made when half the technology that we currently produce didn't exist? As you look internationally too, everybody likes these giant multilateral global trade accords. These are a fairly new thing in global history, aren't they? I mean, they're not the norm. They're the exception. They're very much a post-Cold War entity and a very short, tight period where a lot of attention was put on that, but that may be receding right now. Finally, let's think about world population. Okay. Traditional economic modeling looks at this concept of you're always going to have an increasing labor force, and that's how you have continued growth. Well, that's not the case anymore. That's not the case in Japan. That's not the case in much of Northern Europe. That's not the case soon in the United States. It's not the case in Korea. As you look at the global population change, right, where you have graying population, where you have a reduction in the young people, where you have a change in the labor force, you start to have alternatives that are going to do it. Two things happen. Number one, somebody needs to write new rules for how to assess the future of growth, because Japan has already shown us that something is not right. By every economic model, Japan should have collapsed years and years ago, multiple times, and yet it hasn't. Secondarily, you see different adjustments. So yes, you have increases in efficiency, you have robotization, mechanization, you have the export of industry rather than the import of labor in some places. Half the Japanese cars and sold in America are made in America. Go figure. You also have ways of changing. If we're moving less from a manufacturing and more into a virtual economy or virtual products, why do you need that many people to be able to have the same level of profit? I lived through the dot-com boom and bust in Austin. It was hilarious what the value of thoughts turned out not to be. But what they thought they were, and how you could have that economic growth based on the production of absolutely nothing. So there's always the economic activity of services. But this is the trend that's going on around the world. If you look around the world, the pattern of population and population growth is changing. Countries like the United States, which right now seems to be anti-immigration, are countries that are very well positioned later for actually greater selective immigration. Countries in Europe have a much more difficult time because they've really reached the saturation. If you look at global agriculture, right, and look at the changes in what technology is starting to do for global agriculture, you can now run, if you go up into South Korea, there's a lot of work on this in China and Japan, drones in agriculture that are able to measure crops on a square meter basis, that are able to then deliver water, insecticide and fertilizer on a square meter basis. So what does that do to save resources? All right? So the idea that you're going to hit these resource peaks, technology is allowing these to be moved past. If we're going to sum all of this up, the couple things that I would say to take away as you're looking at the way in which the world is shaping is, number one, the United States is going to be much more selective in its engagement, in where it's going to be, how it's going to be connecting, and how it's going to deploy its resources. Number two, we're going to see a breakdown of the giant multilateral frameworks of global trade that are going to probably start to fracture into regional blocks, sub-regional blocks, and a greater focus on bilateral trade accords. With the US, their two priorities right now are the UK and Japan. For a country like New Zealand, UK pulling out of Brexit reverses all of the mess that happened when they went into the EEC. Maybe it's a good thing, who knows. Then finally, think in terms of the way in which countries are going to be dealing with demographic issues and technological change. If the cell phone was able to create an entirely new type of economy, say in Africa, where they simply skipped a whole step, okay? Imagine if you can have better battery technology development that allows you to have grid storage that allows you to fully utilize non-traditional energy sources, right? And allows you to put them in places. But finally, think if you have this change in manufacturing also, are there going to be countries that were planning on being next in line for that low-end manufacturing rise that are simply going to be bypassed? And are we reaching a point where there are going to be some countries that are just going to be left behind by the global system? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rodger. What I'm going to do actually is give you a chance to take a few questions now, because we're in good time, and then hand over to Philip. There's two ways to do questions. One is put up your hand and a microphone will be brought to you, so please do wait for the microphone. And secondly, using Slido. So if you are, have you got the Slido app and you fancy putting some questions to us that way, please do. Are there some, just a couple of questions for Rodger, and then we'll have Philip from Fonterra, and then we'll have a discussion with the two of them. So plenty more time for discussion. Anything right now? I'm going to jump in with a big one, if I may. Do you have any sense of where US economic policy is going under Trump and the Republicans? In other words, if the Chinese government was asking for your advice, what would you give them?
I think I'm still on. I would say first, don't assume that Trump was a fundamental change in the United States. Yes, it reflects certain changes in the social structure and what's been going on, but he gets about 4,000 appointees in the government. The government is significantly bigger than that. There are a lot of constraints. We have a wonderful political system in the United States that's designed around not working. So it helps. But what I would say is look at things that are very traditional and built off of what was going on under Reagan. And this is the challenge in that they're building a lot of this off of Reagan's changes in tax structure, changes in opportunities for businesses, trying to rewrite the rules on trade. That these may be very good things that happened then. They're going to be a little different in their implementation now. But really, it's going to be how do you get business going? And then the second piece that we're hearing a lot of is how does the US government start to give additional support to its businesses abroad? In other words, the US, particularly as this government has come in, and it's been an issue that's been going on for a while, as you look at the global system, there are a lot of countries that don't play by the rules, that an economic company is in many ways no different than the country behind it. In the United States, they've tried to not necessarily have that the case, sometimes to the detriment of their own companies. This may be changing, and there may be a lot more US government support for the activity of American companies abroad.
Do you have confidence that the competence and integrity of the US government will continue under Trump? Or do you think there's a risk of erosion of those of competence and integrity?
So I try not to play in politics, and this is recorded, so now I'm going to be in lots of trouble. But what I would say is Again, I think that the system has a lot of constraints on the extremes. There are certainly going to be, at least from some sides, a perception of erosion and confidence in the government. But I would argue that over the last 8 years, on the other side, there was a perception of erosion and confidence on the government as well. So it's playing back and forth. The big challenge we have is, can we kind of find something that's going to reunify the nation?
Yes, meanwhile, in the latest Economist Intelligence Unit State of Democracy rankings, the U.S. has slipped to 21st into the category of flawed democracy. How do you feel about that?
That's the EIU, and I think it's a political statement.
Right, yeah. Picking up on some great questions here that are coming through on Slido, there's one down the bottom there. Stratfor research suggests China will fracture into 16 mini-Chinas, and Australia will take a regional role. I think there's two parts to that. Could you tell us a bit more about that research? And then, of course, the second part of that is, what does that mean for us in New Zealand?
So I think as China, as we've been developing that, we don't necessarily see China fracturing completely, but we do see these internal dynamics in China and the regionalism in China actually start to reassert itself in ways that ultimately will push back against this broad centralization. And you already see that in some ways where local governments simply go opposite of what the central government demands of them to do because they have their own local interests. But as we, where'd that one go? Oh, there it is. Australia, we do think, is going to take a larger regional role. I think for New Zealand, again, I'll go back to my opening quote of equality of opportunity amongst nations. This is hard. I'm here, so I have to be careful. But look, New Zealand is a country that in many ways is isolated, which can be a positive benefit. They're not necessarily caught up immediately into some of the broader issues of what is the U.S. and the Chinese doing and how are they competing within the region. I think that gives New Zealand an opportunity to go work as a non-confrontational component in many places, and particularly in the countries that are going to be squeezed between the Americans and the Chinese.
We're very good at that role, so I consider that a great opportunity for us. Look, let's leave it at that for now, and because there'll be plenty of more time for discussion after Philip's had his piece. So a very big hand for Rodger, please. Thank you very much indeed. That's great. Thanks.